Okay, so we're going to today we continue our concept of moving iron meters. Okay, so moving iron meters basically it is mainly used to measure alternating current and voltage. Okay. So it works based on the principle of electromagnetic field induction. Okay. On the surface, on a conductor surface. Okay, so in the configuration, there is a main coil, which carry the current, the alternating current that is being measured. Okay, so on the main coil. So this main coil is carrying the current, the main current. So basically when this coil carry main current, so there will be electromagnetic field induced. Okay. Electromagnetic field induced along the main coil, which will induce the magnetic field on the surface of a conductor. Okay, on the conductor is basically a piece of iron in the middle. Okay. So piece of wire in the middle, and the electromagnetic induce will be opposite the polarity of the main electromagnetic field. So will be electromagnetic induced, okay, and the polarity is, okay, this is the main, this is the on the iron is the opposite. So we know that we have two magnetic with the opposite pole, so they will be an attracting force. Okay. M represent the magnetic pole strength of the main, and M2 represent the magnetic pole strength of the iron core. Okay. So there will be an attracting force, and the attracting force will be proportional to the I mean. Okay, so the iron core, okay, will turn, okay, deflect based on the torque, okay, produced from the interacting between the main magnetic and the iron core or magnetic field, or induced magnetic field. So we can estimate the amount, the value of the I main current, the alternating main current. The similar meter called as dynamo type instrument. The principle is similar to what can be seen from a moving iron meter. So basically the only difference is that the field or construction is much is simpler. Okay, instead of having a main main coil wrap around the iron, moving iron. So now in this construction we have a set, two set of windings, okay, on the sides, okay, on the sides of the moving coil. It works as a similar principle as the moving iron core. The only difference is the construction. Then we have an electrostatic meter. The electrostatic meter basically it works by the principle of charge. Okay. If we have two charge on the surface, okay, and if the charge is different, okay, so there will be pulling force. Okay. So this electrostatic meter is mainly used to measure very high voltage, okay, to up to kilovolts. Yeah, or even megavolt, because this the principle of this electrostatic meter, okay, does not involve any direct contact. Okay, so it works by having two pieces of moving propellers, look like a propeller, big leaf, okay, like what we can be seeing here. So one part of the propeller is fixed and given a positive, or like in this example given a positive potential, and the other part, okay, is given the negative, okay, negative potential. So technically on the first part of the propeller, fixed propeller, okay, it will, you know, carry the positive charge, okay, and the second leaf will carry the negative charge. So when there's basically when the charge are opposite, so the second one will be attracted to the fixed propeller, so it so the moving part will deflect and show the value, which is the deflection torque is proportional to the value of voltage. Okay. So this is mainly used to measure very high voltage. Induction type meter, so basically it based on the rotation of a disc, okay, or rotation of a disc. The purpose of this meter is, you know, to have a continuous rotation. Basically count, okay, the number of rotation per in a certain period of time. Okay. So this is like an analogue counter. Okay, analogue counter count the value, okay, like 1, 0, 1, 8, 7. Number that then it will be continuous like a counter. Okay. Okay. So it works based on the induction of like eddy current. Okay. So in the middle we have a piece of disc, you know, normally, okay, made of aluminium. the aluminium, and this aluminium is basically attached to a spindle, which attached to the analog counter. So when the spindle spin, it will do the counting. The counting. So the faster the spindle turns, the faster the count will happen. So it works like exposing the disc to the electromagnetic field, which is generated from the main current or the current that being measured. So if you can see, there's two set or part of a coil, coil A and coil B. Basically, they are from the same current. So this current in, right, and current out, and then attached to the other part of the coil B, and then this current. So basically, the this coil A and B is the one big part of the coil that carry the main current. Okay, so so coil A and coil B, the only difference is the configuration of the windings. Okay, so what happened, this part of the coil B and will technically produce a different direction of magnetic field. It called coil where a coil A. Okay, so this is this direction. Okay, and this one will generate at a different direction. Different direction. Okay. So these two magnetic fields, they are basically coming from the same current. Okay. Only the configuration is opposite. So creating a different direction of magnetic fields. So when we expose the disc, the conduct, the aluminium disc, it close to the magnetic fields A and B, so they will induce a closed loop current called as eddy current. So the direction of the current will be opposite to the field that producing it. Okay, producing it. So it will be different direction. Okay, so this is direction, and here there will be opposite. Okay, so because they are opposite to the field that is producing it. Okay, so the it will create a basically in general, it will generate a pulling. Okay, but the field that produce on the surface, okay, will attract to the adjacent or the other magnetic field. Okay, so in turn it will create a rotation. Okay, a rotation. And this rotation is proportional to the current. Okay, usually this type of induction type meter is used in a voltmeter. Okay, voltmeter, energy voltmeter used to calculate the energy consumption. Okay, it usually can be found on on the energy meter, the bill meter. Nowadays we have migrate to a digital meter, but this one is an analog meter. May not be seen on the house anymore. Okay, but probably if you go to the old houses or traditional house, still have this kind of meter. Okay. Now we come to voltmeter, the application of voltmeter and ammeter. We're going to start to talk about voltmeter and ammeter. Basically, voltmeter are connected in parallel to measure voltage. Okay, to measure voltage. If we have a circuit, okay, if you have a circuit, okay, for example, in this circuit, look at this circuit. We have a main voltage E, and then a series resistance R, and then a load resistor capital R. And then we okay, want to know measure the voltage across R. So by principle, we connect a voltmeter in parallel to the load that we want to measure. Okay, we want to measure. So that is in principle. And a voltmeter ideally have an infinite resistance. Okay, infinite resistance practically R, okay, is very large. Okay, ideally is close to infinity. So which means should be very very high, okay? So that is an ideal. The ideal voltmeter should have an infinite resistance. Okay, the resistance is very high. Okay, very high, should be around omega ohm. Not less than perhaps less than 1 mega ohm, can be more than 10 mega ohm. Okay, so that is in meter. Whereas for ammeter, the purpose of ammeter is to measure the current. So if we look at the main meter, so we want to measure the current. So an ammeter is basically connected in series, okay, to the circuit, okay, connected in series. So technically we have to cut the main circuit and then connect an ammeter in series, okay, in series, okay. So technically the ammeter will directly be a part, okay, of the main circuit that we want to measure the current. Okay, so therefore the resistance of ammeter should ideally have a zero resistance, okay, or zero resistance or low. This is, so it should be low, voltmeter should be high. So we have to remember that. Okay. So the internal resistance, R, internal resistance, the over ammeter should be low or close to 0 ohm. Okay, we will look into that concept later. Now we look at the voltage measurement technique. Okay, the voltage can be measured by passing a current through a resistor. Okay, so basically voltmeter can be seen as a very high resistor ammeter connected in parallel with the circuit being measured. Okay. So it should have a high resistance compared to the circuit that we want to measure. Okay. So a voltmeter consists of a PMMC in this example, PMMC, okay, permanent magnet moving coil, or the unsolvable device, or the unsolvable device. Okay. Connected in series with the multiplier we call as a element. Okay. And here in this example V, okay, V is the range. The range of voltage can be measured by this voltmeter. Okay, V. So V can be 0 to 10 volt, 0 to 1 volt, 0 to 10 volt, 0 to 100 volt, and so on. Okay. And there is a core sensitivity. Sensitivity is equivalent to 1 over Im, or sometimes 1 over IFSD. FSD is full scale deflection. Full scale deflection. Okay, so meaning that if we design a circuit or a voltmeter that can measure 0 to 1 volt, okay, so the when the scale is at the highest, which will be equivalent to Im, okay, but the multiplier will determine or limit the current IFSD, and also the PMMC or the isolated device have its internal resistance. Okay, so this is a design, so basically a design. So let's say we have a circuit that want to measure the voltage, so we connect the voltmeter in series with the circuit that we want to measure. Okay, so then we have to design the voltmeter. Okay, so to design the voltmeter is a few things that you have to know. First, you have to know the range of voltage. Number two, you have to know the full scale deflection current. You have to know the full scale deflection current. Number three, you have to know the internal resistance of the voltmeter, sometimes called as RG or RM. Okay. Full scale deflection is IM, sometimes IG, okay, sometimes IFSD. They are referring to the same thing. Okay. Number four, when we know 1, 2, 3, so we can determine RS. Okay, then we can determine the RS. Okay. Also, from the second, we can determine the sensitivity. Okay, sensitivity. This is the sensitivity of the voltage meter. Okay, so the voltmeter, okay, like ammeter or ohmmeter, are designed with the use of a sensitive current detector, galvanometer, okay, galvanometer or PMMC, or the unsolvable device. So just don't be confused, they are referring to the same thing. Okay, the galvanometer or PMHC or the unsolvable device, they are referring to the same thing. Okay, IG is the current, is the current to give full scale reading or full scale deflection. Okay. RG is the internal resistance, and RS is the current limiting resistor, which is connected in series with the voltmeter. Okay. So the purpose of the series resistor here, RS, is to limit the current. Okay, so that the maximum will stay at IG. Okay, will not go over IG. Okay, so remember that the galvanometer is very fragile. Okay, it is not being designed to carry high current or the high DC current. Otherwise, it will break the connection, because the galvanometer, okay, exactly consists of a very thin coil wrapped around the core. So if the current is too high, it will like basically break, or due to the heat, okay, the extreme heat caused by the high current, will basically break the wire, okay, melt the wire. Okay, so usually the IG is in the order of milliampere, or milliampere, sometimes it's 100 microampere. Usually we will not be more than that. The IG usually will be not more than that range. 100 microampere is around 0.1 milliampere. So it will not be that more than that. Okay, so let's look at this example, or this an example. Okay. So we have, let's say we have a circuit. R1, R2. Okay, we have a circuit. Then we want to measure the voltage across R2. Okay. And then, given that the specification, we need to design a voltmeter. Let's say we don't know what is VR2, we don't know. We have no idea. But from the spec, we know that VR2 lies in between 0 to 30 volt. Okay, so 0 to 30 volt. Okay, let's say we are confident, we assume that VR2 lies between 0 to 30 volt. So we need to design a voltmeter that can measure voltage between 0 to 30 volt. Okay. So regardless the value of VR2, we basically know or assume that VR2 the value is between 0 to 30 volt. Okay, 30 volt. So how to design a voltmeter that can make that such measurement? So we need to find we need to identify a few things lah. For example, what is the range? Okay, so in this case, the range of the voltage. Okay, we know that the voltmeter will be connected in series. Okay. So V is our voltmeter. So now we know that the range is 0 to 30 volts. Is 0 to 30 volts. So this will be the V design. Okay, V design. Okay. Okay, then we need to know the maximum deflection current, IFSD, meaning that when the deflection is at the maximum, what is the IG? Okay. So we know that we know usually this IG or the maximum deflection current is given in the specification, but we can determine or we can put an assumption in the milliamp scale or milliamp order. So let's say when the deflection is at 30 volt, okay, so the IG is equivalent to 3 milliamp, let's say. Okay, now and also we know that, let's say, the internal resistance, okay, RG, internal resistance of the PL galvano is around 1000 ohm, okay, or 1 kilo ohm, okay, 1 kilo ohm. So we know that, we already know that three things. Okay, next we need to be to design what to determine what is RS. Okay. So V design. Okay. Okay, and this is IG. Okay. This is a complete circuit. Okay. Okay. So we use KVL. Okay, use KVL. So use KVL, we get negative V design. Plus IG multiply with RS plus IG multiply with RG equivalent to 0. Okay. We rearrange this. Okay, we get RS equivalent to V design. Over IG minus RG. Okay. So 1 over IG is sensitivity. Sensitivity is equivalent to 1 over IG. Okay. So that is sensitivity. Sensitivity. So we can write RS equivalent to S multiply V design minus RG. Okay, so we can write like that. So S is the sensitivity, which is equivalent 1 over IG. So in this case is 1 over 3 milliamp. 1 over 3 milliamp. Okay, and the unit is 1 over IG, unit is 1 over ampere, or the unit is for ohm per volt. Okay, so that's the unit. So we got the equation Okay, to find what is the value of RS. So V design is 30 volt. IG is 3 milliamp, and RG is 1,000 or 1 kΩ. So in conclusion, RS will be equivalent to 9,000 ohm or 9 kΩ. Okay, so now we have complete a design of a voltmeter, okay, that can measure voltage between 0 to 30 volt. Okay, so this is how we design. Okay, so let's look at this example. Okay, a diasorbal movement device or galvanometer, basically a galvanometer. With a full scale deflection. Okay, full scale deflection is basically IG. Full scale deflection of 100 microampere or 0.1 milliamp, and has an internal resistance of 100 ohm. Is used as a voltmeter. Determine the value of RS. What is the RS? To measure a voltage range 0 to 1 volt. Okay. So basically, this is the design. Okay. Okay, so in the input of the voltage, 0 to 10 volt. 0 to 10 volt. Okay, and IG and this is RS, and RG is the internal resistance. Okay, so we need to determine the suitable value of RS. So how we determine is we have to determine from the maximum V design or V input. Okay, the maximum V input. So the maximum V input is basically is the V design. Okay. So negative V design plus IG RS plus IG RG equivalent to 0. So we rearrange RS will be equivalent to redesign over IG minus RG. Okay, so V design is the maximum input, okay, and volt. And when the input is maximum, okay, the IG will be equivalent to the full scale deflection. So in this case, is 0.1 milli and minus 1,000. So if we, how much is that? We will use calculate it. much is that? If I'm not mistaken, around 99.98. So RS is 99.9K. If I'm not mistaken. Right. Okay, next, this is a single range, a single range voltmeter, but in most application we need the advantage of having a multiple range voltmeter. An example is what you have on a multimeter, where you have a dial, you can select the range, okay, voltmeter range. So this is an example of a multi-range DC voltmeter. Okay, but in this example, of course, in terms of practicality, it works. Only one switch will be closed. Okay, only one switch will be closed at one time. Okay, assuming that if one is closed, the other will be reset or open. Okay. So in this example, the voltmeter with the galvanometer has an internal resistance of 50 ohm. The RM is 50 ohm. And then the maximum in reflection current is 1 milliamp. So this is 1 milliamp. RM is 50 ohm. Okay. So I need to measure 4 different range, 0 to 100, 0 to 50 volt, 0 to 100, and 0 to 1 volt, as shown by this figure. Assuming that at one time only one switch will be closed. Okay? For example, if this switch is closed, only RS will be in series with the galvanometer. So if this is, assume this is the first switch, when this first switch is closed, then it will, the range of the measurement will be between 0 to 1 volt, okay? 0 to 1 volt, and only one resistor connected in series with the galvanometer. But if the second one is closed, if the second one is closed, the rest is open. Okay, the range is between 0 to 1 volt, but in the second configuration or second second option here, R3 plus R4 is the equivalent series resistance value. Okay, and so on. So we need to find the value of R1, R2, R3, and R4. So basically, the value will indirectly related to the range. Okay, and to the range to the input range. So how to find? We start at the first one. Okay, it's from 0 to 1 volt. Okay, from 0 to 1 volt, we find R4. Okay. So you can use the KVL. Okay, KVL, then you find R4 is equivalent to 950 ohm. Okay. On the second range, okay, remember that when the second range, when the 0 to 10 volt, So R3 will be, or the equivalent series resistor will be R3 plus R4. Okay, R3 plus R4. Therefore, you see here, okay, term R4 will be included. Okay, so from 0 to 10 volt, the equivalent value of R3, it will be V in, or V in is V design, okay, V design, or the maximum input, okay, for the second range, over the IM is the maximum deflection current. Maximum deflection current will always remain the same at any instant here. Okay. Minus Rm plus R4. Okay. Therefore, we get that from range 0 to 10 volt, the R3, okay, will be equivalent to 9 kilo ohm. So, this is like repeating the previous step. Okay, but you always it always helpful for if you redraw the circuit. You redraw the circuit, find the equivalent circuit, and then work the answer from the circuit that you have redrawn. Okay, so finally, the other, like range 0 to 50 volt, R2 is 40 kilo ohm, and 0 to 100 ohm, R1 will be 50 kilo ohm. Okay. So this is a multi-range voltmeter. Okay. Look at this other example. Okay. This example, instead of having a multiple switch, so we have a switch. Okay. This is called as the common, okay, common point. Okay. So this connection. This connection basically will like a fan switch, correct? So you can toggle, or you can change the option. Okay, only just one option can be made at one time. Can be made at one time. Of course. Similar to the previous one, this is just a matter of reconfiguration. You need to figure out what is the equivalent series resistance when you select the range. Okay, you select the range. Okay. So for example, if you select 5 volt in range 0 to 5 volt, so the equivalent resistance is R1. But if you select 20 volt, okay, if the switch is okay, the option, okay, change here. Okay, so the equivalent this side, okay, this side of the, okay, will be the main circuit, and the rest will not include in the calculation to determine the series resistance value when we select the range from 0 to 20 volts. Okay. So this is being a value, the internal value of Rm is 5 kilo ohm. Okay. And the maximum IFSD is 0.1 milliamp, or 100 microampere basically. Okay, so calculate the sensitivity of the voltmeter. Sensitivity is S equivalent to 1 over IG, or 1 over Im or 1 over IFSD. I list everything, every possible names, so that you won't be confused. If in some notes they use IG, some notes they use IM, some notes they use IFSD, but they are referring to the same thing. Okay, so sensitivity, okay, is basically okay, 1 over, in this case IFSD is 1 over IFSD. So S is equivalent to 1 over 0.1 milliamp. That will be equivalent to what? That will be equivalent to 10 K. The unit is ohm per volt. Ohm per volt. Okay. Then 10 K ohm per volt. That's the unit. Sensitivity. Right, so next calculate the resistance value, okay, for R1, R2, R3 and R4. So remember, it's good practice as an engineer, you have to include the circuit, you have to show the circuit, okay. It's a very good habit as an engineer. So imagine you as an architect, okay, when you want to describe a house design or any design, you use your drawings. Similarly, like your electrical engineer, electric circuit is circuits is like your body and soul. Okay, so how to calculate the resistance, the R1, R2, R4, so start, okay, with the first range, okay. It's okay. You design zero, yeah, from 0 to 5 volts. Okay. So only R1 will be involved. Okay. Put and then you can design here. Okay. You can draw RM or RG, then no problem. Okay, so this is RM, and this is IFSD. Okay, so R1 equivalent to V design during 0 to 5. Let's put V design 1 over IFSD minus RM. Okay, so we know that IFSD, I over IFSD is the sensitivity. Okay, so you can be, you can also write this S multiply with V design 1 minus RM. Okay, same thing. Okay, you can write like that. Okay, so this R1 will be equivalent to 10K multiply with 5 minus 5K. That will be like 50K minus 5K. You will get 45 kilo ohm. Okay, now you have done, you got the 45. I think the rest, okay, like the second one, 0 to 20 volt. Okay, basically the circuit will be involved R2 R1 Rm. This is your input. Okay, so the V design is 20 volt. Okay, so technically R2 will be AS multiply V design 2 minus R1 plus RM. Okay, so it will be 10k multiplied with 20 foot. Okay, 10k multiplied with 20 foot, it will be 200k minus R1 plus Rm. Okay, basically R1 plus Rm is 50k. Therefore, R true is what? It's around 150k. Oh, okay. So I think you can figure out the rest of the answer. Okay, it's just a matter of just repeating the same process. If you don't understand, you can ask me the later. Some safety precaution when you are using a voltmeter. Always connect a voltmeter in parallel. Okay, never connect in series. Okay. And then always start with the highest range. Okay. So if you might have this multiple range, you start with the highest range. Okay, of course. Why? Imagine if you don't know the input, but you start at the lowest range. Okay, so the deflection will be too large. Okay, will causing the needle to swing too fast. Okay, deflect too fast, okay, and then hit the side, inside, the inside part of the meter, so it will eventually cause damage, okay, due to unnecessary due to the wrong selection of range, right? And then the third one is to de-energize or discharge. Okay, before connecting or disconnecting the meter. So what it can do is usually the voltmeter will come with a two set of probe. Okay, usually one is in black color, one is in red color. Okay. This is a probe. So what you do, you touch, okay. Touch the probe for a few seconds. Okay. Touch the probe for a few seconds to make sure the current has been discharged, de-energized. Never use a DC voltmeter to measure DC. Never use a DC voltmeter to measure AC voltage. What will happen that the meter will swing rapidly left and right, left and right. And then the swing rate the swing rate will give actually depend on the frequency of the AC signal, AC voltage. So that also will basically cause unnecessary damage. And also observe the polarity. Okay, don't mistakenly connect the probe. Okay, positive probe must be connected to positive voltage, and negative or ground have to be connected to the ground. Otherwise, the deflection will go or will swing at the wrong direction. That's a voltage safety precaution. Usually we going to observe that in the lab, okay, but we don't have the privilege to go to the lab this semester. And also the assignment, we'll start to release the assignment when we finish chapter 2B, 2B when we finish discussion about the Western Bridge. Okay. Okay, now we discuss about the concept of voltmeter or loading effect. Okay. So basically voltmeter, okay, always connected in parallel to the circuit or to the load that we want to measure. That is the basic principle. Okay. Any current through the voltmeter contribute to the overall current in the test circuit. What it means basically, okay, like this example, when we connect a voltmeter to a circuit, okay, so a circuit have its own current, let's say I. Okay. Let's say I, and then okay, if we look at the other part of the circuit, okay, we assume that will be I so on. But when we make a connection here, okay, point one and point two, you see that there is a branch. Okay, we are creating a branch to the main circuit. Okay. So definitely this main current, okay, remember the Kirchhoff current. Okay, the total amount of input will be equivalent to the output, right? The sum of current will be equivalent to zero, if you remember Kirchhoff current. So I here we separate that, we can write this is as I 2 and this is I 3. Okay. And at this part, so this is I3. So we know that I is equivalent to I2 plus I3. Okay. So, in practical, when we introduce a voltmeter, so we will draw some current. In practical, it will draw some current. In this case, it will draw I3. Okay? I3. So that what makes the deflection. Okay? Although we may actually want to know the voltage. Okay? The voltage across 200 mega ohm, but inevitably the voltmeter will draw some current. It will draw some current. And a perfect voltmeter has infinite resistance. So but in perfect it draw zero. Perfect. This is perfect. Perfect. But remember that voltmeter depend on deflection. It depends on the full the current deflection current, the deflection current. Okay. So it means that it must take some current, it must draw some current, so that it shows the deflection. So in practical, I3 will not be. It cannot be equivalent to zero. Okay. But that's why we have to limit I3. Okay. Usually for ideal or good voltmeter, it will take maximum 0.1 milliamps, very small. But that 0.1 milliamp is enough to show the deflection. Okay, on the voltmeter. Okay, or the galvanometer. Okay, let's look at this example. Okay, let's look at this example. is a simple example. We have supply, DC supply with 25 volts. Okay, connected in series with R1 and R2. Okay, in series. Okay. So let's say by calculation, the voltage across R2, okay, here VR2 plus minus ER2, ER2, it can be determined from the voltage divider ER2 equivalent to, let's say this is the main, we call it as capital E, E multiply with R2 resistance over R1, the total resistance of the circuit, because we only two series. So here we get 5 multiple with 10 over 10 plus 15. So you get 10 volts. Okay, 10 volts. So the ER2 a by calculation is 10 volts. Okay. So now you remember that. Okay. Let's say we voltmeter, and the voltmeter has an internal resistance of 10 ohm. What does it mean? Okay. Can we write that as a voltmeter here? Voltmeter. Okay. Remember, a voltmeter. Okay. Voltmeter. But basically, a voltmeter consists of the series resistor plus the of the galvanometer, right? So the resistance R internal will be equivalent to RS plus RM. And in this case, the internal resistance is represented by R3. So we put that R3 equivalent to 10 ohm. Okay. Internal resistance. Okay. So when we put or connect the voltmeter into the across or in parallel with R2, because we want to measure the voltage. Measure R2. I'm sorry again, I don't know why they have to write. Anyway, we want to measure the voltage. Okay. Measure. So we want to measure. Calculation we got 10 volt. Calculation we got 10 volt. But let's say we want to measure using a voltmeter. Okay. And voltmeter here in this case has an internal resistance of 10 ohm. Okay. 10 ohm. Okay. 10 ohm. So when it becomes a part, okay, of the when we connect to in with R2, it become a part of the main circuit. Okay, part of the main circuit. So it will actually looks like this. So this is the ER2, the prime. So this is R2, and this is the R3. Remember that R3, we assume that is the internal resistor of the voltmeter we just connect in parallel with VR2, and this is R1. You see that R3 is now become a part of the circuit. Okay, so how do we calculate ER2 now? ER2. So ER2 prime is now E multiply with the equivalent value of this part R2 and R3, R2 parallel with R3 over R2 parallel with R3 plus R1. Okay. So previous we only have this one R2 term. Okay, we have R2 parallel with R3. So now the equivalent value of this part is no longer 10 ohm, but it has become 5 ohm. So E now by calculation 5, it is 25. Multiply with 5 over 5 plus 10. So now E has become 6.25 volts. You see, due to the internal resistance of the voltmeter, the I collection value, which is supposed to be 10 volts, now the voltage across R2 here, when we connect a voltmeter with a low resistance, value has dropped to 6.25 volts. Okay, so that is what the voltmeter indicate. Okay, that is what is shown on the voltmeter due to the internal resistance of the voltmeter. So this is what called as the loading effect. Okay, so the addition of the meter R3 has loaded the circuit. Okay, has caused an error to the measurement, okay, as compared to the calculation. So this is what is called as loading effect. Okay. But if you repeat, okay, if you repeat the process, okay, by using a voltmeter, okay, instead of last time, the previous example, we have a voltmeter 10 ohm, the internal resistance is 10 ohm. Okay, so we use another one, a voltmeter with the internal resistance, in this case 10 kilo ohm higher internal resistance. So if you repeat, if you could follow the same process I explained before, okay, now we use a voltmeter with high input resistance, okay, in this case 10 kilo ohm. Okay, the input resistance is 10 kilo ohm. So if you can observe, you calculate, you can you calculate the value, so the output now will be 9.99 volt, okay, which is very close to the actual output, okay? Very close to the actual output, okay? So in this case, the voltmeter has a very high input resistance or input impedance. Therefore, it has reduced the error, the measurement error. Okay. So that's why in this and figure C or on by using a higher voltmeter with high input impedance, we can reduce the error or eliminate the loading effect. So example, and in this by using this voltmeter, there is no significant current being drawn out from the main circuit. Okay, so if you look at this example, discuss the permanent magnet moving coil movement, which include the principle. I think you can refer to the notes. Okay, you can start with explaining the structures of the PMMC. The main structures, like for PMMC, start with have a permanent magnet and also have a rotating coil in the center, and also spring control, and then as a needle attached on the moving coil, and then there's an indicator. Okay. Then, and then next you explain the principle when the current flow through the moving coil. Okay. It will generate a magnetic field which will interact with the permanent magnet, producing a torque, and then the torque is proportional to the current, okay, to the current, input current. Then the moving coil will deflect, and then the deflection we stop when the deflection current, the deflection torque equivalent to the restoring torque by the spring. Okay, then when the current is released, the deflection will return to zero. So, that's pretty much full mark you can achieve. Remember to list the structure, the component and components, draw the circuit or draw the schematic diagram, and also explain the principle. Okay. Then figure 3B shows the connection of a voltmeter to measure the potential difference of across R2. Given the sensitivity of the meter is 25 kilo ohm volt per volt. Okay, so that is the sensitivity. Yes, equivalent to 25 k ohm per volt. Okay. Determine the voltage reading and percentage of error for each reading if the range of voltmeter is 5 volt and 10 volt. Okay. So given that the sensitivity is 25 k ohm per volt, okay. So here we don't know the internal resistance, okay, but pretty much, okay, you can estimate, okay, the internal resistance from the design lah, from the design. So here is given the voltmeter design is 10 volt, 5 volt and 10 volt. So you know that V design equivalent to, sorry, not V design. Is equivalent to IG multiply with RG plus RM. RG plus RM is basically the internal resistance. Internal resistance. The internal resistance. So we can call it as R internal resistance. So the internal resistance is equivalent to V design over IG or V design multiply with the sensitivity. Right. So for 5 volt, the internal resistance, it is the 5 volt will be V design is 5 volt multiply with 25 k. It is around what? 75? No, more than that. 125 k. That is the internal resistance for 5 volt. Internal resistance for while so internal resistance for 10 volt will be 10 multiply with 25 k, so that is 250 k ohm. Okay. So you can first calculate the output, without the voltmeter, okay, by calculation using the voltage divider. Next, consider the output when use the voltmeter, and then you can calculate the percentage of error. Percentage of error will be equivalent to VR2, okay, by using voltmeter, minus the VR2 ideal without the voltmeter, divide by VR2 ideal without the voltmeter, multiply with 100. So that's how you can calculate the percentage of error. Okay. Then you can make the conclusion. And then now the third one you can use the assumption lah. Okay, the measure the third one. I think I stop here. For this week. Okay. And we will continue this Thursday. So if you have I will give you some time. Perhaps if you don't have any question. Okay. So, thank you, and see you again this Thursday.